So we'll talk about the characteristics of seedlings at three different life stages, as well as the qualities of a mature transplant and the environmental conditions that are ideal for each stage of life. Generally, we're wanting to provide moisture that is more shallow as when we have a younger seedling, and with increasing depth and decreasing frequency as seedlings get older. We're also wanting to think about temperatures. For warm-seeded crops, it can be really helpful to use bottom heat, such as an electric heating mat, to control the temperature, as warm-seeded crops generally like soil air temperatures of 75 to 78 degrees. So at this early stage of life, we are wanting to supply even consistent moisture to our seeds in order to have the seeds imbibe enough moisture to break their seed coat and break dormancy. You can see here that this seed has broken, the radicle has busted out of the seed coat and is starting to grow. And here you can see just a little bit farther along the start of a branching root system and the cotyledons starting to push out as well. When we have newly sown or recently germinated flats, we want to provide water when the dry down of the soil surface is around 50 to 75% soil capacity. So we're really wanting to make sure that the soil surface is pretty uniformly moist consistently. There are some exceptions to think about, as things that have larger seeds tend to imbibe more water and are more prone to rotting, such as sunflowers, cucurbits, and other big-seeded things. So these actually can tolerate more of a wet-dry swing. So at this stage of life, you'll see that we have cotyledons have emerged. Cotyledons are the seed leaves, or where food is stored. And we also see the beginning of the true leaves starting to emerge on these. So here are our cotyledons, and here is the start of the true leaves starting to emerge. At this stage, you also see the beginning of a root system that is starting to branch and develop as well. Hopefully, you have a pretty good balance between root development and shoot development if your seedling mix is well made. At this stage of life, we'll be wanting to increase the water to meet the root depth of our seedling. And in the beginning, you'll be just watering enough to meet the root depth, but gradually you'll want to increase the watering to meet the full length of the roots. We'll want to water when around 75% of the soil surface appears dry, generally. And sometimes a few times a day, but it really depends on the weather. So at this stage of life, we're seeing the continued development of true leaves, as well as the continued development of the root knit and root ball. And ideally, we're having a really balanced ratio of shoot development to root development, and a root knit that is starting to hold together really well. At this stage of life, we're wanting to water to the full depth of the bottom of the tray so that we can really meet the needs of all of those roots. We can wait to water until the soil surface is about 100% actually dried down, and even seeing about an inch or so of dry down within a plug. There's a lot more of a tolerance window for having dry down when the seedlings are a bit older. So the qualities of a mature transplant will be the following. At least two sets of true leaves. Here we have one, two, and a well-developed root system that holds together well in a root knit. And we'll also want to see the development of stronger stems. So at this point, it's a really great time to harden off your seedlings by putting them outside of your greenhouse and exposing them to normal daytime and nighttime temperatures and light conditions. And that will allow the seedlings to develop and strengthen their cell walls, as well as build carbohydrate reserves and reduce the risk of transplant shock when you're planting out into your field. So another thing to think about when growing seedlings is when you're going to transplant and when you don't have the ability to transplant right away, either because you don't have the time or your field isn't ready, maybe it's too wet. We need to think about strategies to hang on to your seedlings as long as possible. This is called holding. So you can see with these squash seedlings, they are actually starting to lose their vibrant green color. They're not too far along yet, but very quickly they're going to outrun the space in their cells. They're going to utilize all those nutrients and not be very happy in this plug tray. So when you don't have the ability to transplant right away, there's a couple of different strategies you can employ to hang on to your plants a little bit longer. Number one, you can move them to a slightly shadier or cooler location, moving them out of the greenhouse to slow the growth. Number two, you can actually apply a supplemental fertility to replace the nutrients that they have run out of in their cells and push their ability to hold in the cell a little bit longer. You can also, it's also important to know which crops you can actually do this with successfully. There are some crops like tomatoes and kale, which will spring back really well after being held for a little bit too long. But if you have other things like bulbing onions or heading brassicas, these things are not as resilient to being held in the tray too long. So it's important to have a knowledge of which crops that you can actually do this with successfully. When you have a transplant that is past its prime, you'll see the leaf color starting to change. You'll see perhaps the root ball starting to become too dense. These are not quite at that stage yet, but soon we'll see the root ball becoming a little bit too tight, and maybe you'll even start to see discoloration of the roots. In some trays, like these styrofoam trays, the roots will actually start to grip into the tray, and so when you go to pull out the plug, they'll actually be gripping and growing into the tray, which is difficult. So that's definitely a sign that you are waiting too long. You'll also start to see some yellowing of foliage, and probably the cotyledons will begin to fall off, as those are no longer needed as a stored food resource. But you'll want to think sooner rather than later about how to manage your transplants if you aren't able to get them in the ground. Another holding strategy to address your seedlings when you cannot plant out immediately is to actually pot up into larger containers. So you can move your seedlings up into a container that provides more nutrients as well as more root space. Although this is time intensive and labor intensive, it can actually help provide another week or even a couple weeks of time to your seedlings if you're unable to plant right away. So blocking is a really important part of managing your greenhouse. Blocking is the organization of your plug trays by life cycle, by type, and by crop type in order to most effectively manage the plant needs as well as your space. So here you see an example of us having all of our recently sown and newly germinated trays together. And that way they can all receive moisture more frequently and less deeply. If you're hand watering, it's really helpful to have everything set together that needs more frequent watering. And if you're watering with an automated system, this will help you set your schedules appropriately. Here we have mature seedlings that are blocked by crop type. And you can see they're also packed in as close as they can be to maximize our space on the greenhouse benches. And as we move this way, you can see that we have seedlings that are less further along in their life cycle, and they're all grouped together as well by crop type. So we've got our chards here, lettuces here. It is also helpful to group by cell type. So we have our squashes here that are in 72 trays, and they are together because they will end up having a slightly different dry down pattern than a seedling that's in a plastic tray, for instance. And over here, we have our seedlings that are at a younger stage of life with true leaves just barely starting to emerge. And again, they are grouped by crop type. And then cell type, over here we have all of our 72s together in the styrofoam trays. And then this whole block is this young life cycle. So that'll allow us to more efficiently tailor water needs to their life cycle. In maximizing the space efficiency in your greenhouse, it's also helpful to think about the footprint that your trays have. A common size footprint is a 13 by 26 inch tray size, or in greenhouse production, also 10 by 20s. So it's helpful if you have all of your trays utilizing the same footprint so they can line up on your benches most effectively. Even if they have different cell types, if you can maintain the same footprint, that'll help you manage your space more efficiently. Here's an example of a pretty poorly blocked setup. You see that we have different life stages of plants, from mature to just recently sown to middle age life cycle, as well as different tray types, from wooden flats to plastic trays to styrofoam trays that are all different cell sizes, as well as footprints. So with the varying footprint between this and this and this, that combination makes it really hard to effectively manage the space in the limited greenhouse space that you may have, as well as uniformly deliver water and meet the environmental needs of the seedlings. So if we were to block this well, we would try and put all the like footprint sized trays with each other, as well as block by life cycle, and then even block by crop type. So in this inefficient setup, you can see that because of the varying tray footprints, we actually have some gaps here and here, and in that instance, we would be wasting water or wasting fertility inputs or energy, because we're essentially having to still address that area within the crops. Okay, here's an example of a well-blocked area in the greenhouse. We have our crops organized by crop type. Here you can see our lettuces together, brassicas, some chard. All of the trays also have the same footprint and cell size. So this is allowing us to really maximize our space and deliver water uniformly across the crops. You can also see that we have a block over here that is a little bit less developed. So these should be able to receive less water on a slightly more frequent schedule than the more developed seedlings.